Hello students, up to now we have seen the CE amplifier analysis with and without emitter resistance and bypass capacitors. Now we are going to see the AC load line analysis of a CE amplifier. So we already know the DC load line. So the DC load line will give you the relationship between the transistor characteristics and the Q point. Okay. So the DC load line gives us a way of visualizing the relationship between the Q point and transistor characteristics. But if we are introducing some capacitors in our CE amplifier circuit, like the coupling capacitor or the bypass capacitor or load capacitor or something else, a new effective load line will exist on the output characteristics. That is called as AC load line. Okay. So the AC load line analysis will exist for the AC input signals, okay, for AC input signals, and the circuit should contain the capacitors. Okay, so whenever the circuit is containing the capacitors, which means that we are using that circuit for AC amplification. If we are introducing some AC signal into our circuit, then definitely the DC load line will not give you the response of that AC signal. So we have to go for another load line analysis, that is called as AC load line analysis. The AC load line which helps you to visualizing the relationship between the small signal response and the transistor characteristic, which means that it is giving the relationship for AC signals and the transistor characteristics. In order to find out the AC load line, we are going to take one CE amplifier circuit like this. We have already derived the equations for the DC load line analysis, and now we are going to get the AC load line analysis equations. In order to get the AC load line equations, we are going to take this CE amplifier. So here VS and RS are forming the signal source and its source resistance, and the CC is the coupling capacitor, and RB is the biasing resistor, which may be equal to R1 parallel R2 if it is a self bias. RC is the collector resistance, and emitter is containing the two resistors. One is RE1, another one is RE2. In parallel with the RE2, we are going to give one CE, emitter bypass capacitor. This transistor is operating with two supply voltages. One is V+, which was given to the collector terminal, and another one is a V-, which was given to the emitter terminal. Now we are going to get the DC load line points first of all. After that, we are going to get the AC load line points. Okay. In order to get the DC load line, we are going to apply the KVL for output side loop. As it is a DC load line analysis, we are going to apply the DC signals. Okay, the current flowing in the collector terminal is IC, and the current flowing in emitter terminal is IE. Okay, so now I am going to apply the KVL equation. So V+ is equal to IC into RC, the drop in the resistor, RC plus VCE, which is the voltage across the collector terminal to the emitter terminal, and the emitter terminal is containing two resistors, RE1 plus RE2. Okay, so the same current IE is flowing in these both resistors, therefore IE into RE1 plus RE2, and we have one more negative supply voltage, V-. Okay, that is about the KVL for output side loop, and we know that the emitter current, which is equal to 1 plus beta by beta into IC. Actually, we know the relationship. The emitter current IE is equal to 1 plus beta times of IB, base current. Okay, and one more relationship we know. IC is equal to what? Beta times of IB. That is the IC collector current equation. So from this collector current equation IC, we can get IB is equal to what? IB is equal to IC by beta. Okay. Therefore, we can substitute IC by beta in the place of IB in the IE equation. Therefore, we can get it as IE is equal to 1 plus beta into, instead of IB, I am substituting IC by beta. Therefore, IC divided by beta. Okay, so now I am substituting IE is equal to 1 plus beta by beta into IC, like that. Okay, here I am going to get the VCE from the above equation. VCE is equal to, here we have V plus, and here we have V minus. Okay, we can take to this side V plus minus of V minus minus IC into, in this equation we have RC, okay, minus of RC. If you take this one, so IE was replaced with 1 plus beta by beta into IC, therefore 1 plus beta into beta, IC was taken as common, into RE1 plus RE2, which was mentioned here. Okay, so that is the output voltage VCE equation, and we know that the beta is very much greater than 1, therefore we can neglect the 1 from this equation, so that beta beta will get cancelled, so which will be equal to 1 approximately. Therefore, the above equation can be written as VCE is equal to V plus minus V minus minus IC into RC plus RE1 plus RE2. Okay, so from this equation, in order to get the DC load line points on X axis and Y axis, we are going to substitute once VCE is equal to 0 and IC is equal to 0. If we assume the VCE is equal to 0, then we can get the IC equation. IC is equal to minus of V plus minus V minus by RC plus RE1 plus RE2. Okay, in the next case, I am going to substitute IC is equal to 0. Okay, in this case, when we put VC is equal to 0, we got the point on the Y axis, okay, for the DC load line. And when we put IC is equal to 0, then we can get the X axis point, okay, which is VCE. Okay, so when you put IC is equal to 0, this entire term will be equal to 0, and VCE is equal to V plus minus of V minus. Okay, that is the value of the VCE. Okay, when IC is equal to 0, that is the point on X axis. Now we can draw the DC load line by using these two points, VCE, IC, which are the equations of the DC load line here. From this IC equation, we can write the slope of the DC load line, which will be equal to 1 by RC plus RE1 plus RE2. That is the slope of the DC load line equation. Okay, so the DC load line equation is 1 by of this resistance value. Okay, now we are going to get the AC load line points. In order to get the AC load line, I am going to ground all the DC sources that are present in the circuit. So the V plus has been grounded, and the V minus is also grounded here. And also I am going to ground all the capacitors that are present in the circuit. So this CE, emitter bypass capacitor, is also grounded. Therefore, if you see here, RE2 is in parallel with the short circuit. Okay, therefore there is no effect of RE2 resistance. We can neglect it from the equivalent circuit. Okay, therefore RE1 is directly grounded. Okay, because the capacitor has been short circuited. Now we are going to apply the KVL equation for output side loop. That will be equal to, so as I am assuming it is an AC circuit, okay, now only AC signals will be there, so that I am giving the notations small I small c. Okay, that is the AC collector current flowing in the collector terminal, and here the VCE, small VCE, that is the AC output voltage, and the AC emitter current, which is equal to small IE. Okay, therefore we can write the output KVL equation like small IC into RC plus VCE plus IE into RE1. There is no RE2 term because it was grounded. Okay, and which is equal to 0 because we don't have any sources at the output side. Okay, and we are assuming IC current is approximately equal to IE current. Therefore, here IC into RC, here IC into RE1, we can common the IC. Therefore, if you take IC as common, IC into RC plus RE1, okay, and also we are going to get the VCE. So VCE is equal to, this term will go to the right hand side and become minus term. VCE is equal to minus IC into RC plus RE1 we get. This equation is for the AC load line, and the slope of the this AC load line will be given as this one, minus 1 by RC plus RE1, because from this equation IC can be written as IC is equal to VCE divided by RC plus RE1, and we have a minus also. Okay, IC is equal to minus VCE by RC plus RE1. Therefore, the slope of this AC load line will be equal to minus 1 by RC plus RE1. that is the slope of the AC load line. The slope of the AC load line differs from that of DC load line because the emitter resistance RE2 is not included in the small signal equivalent circuit. Because the emitter capacitor CE has been grounded or short circuited, therefore there is no effect of RE2. That's why there is a change in the slope of the DC load line as well as the AC load line. Okay, so in the DC load line, if you see, the slope is -1 by RC plus RE1 plus RE2. That is an extra term. Okay, if RE2 will be there, that is nothing but the DC load line slope. If RE2 is not present, that is nothing but the AC load line slope. That is the only difference. So the AC load line will occur only when we have the AC signal as input. The DC load line will occur only when DC signal as an input signal. Okay. So the small signal CE voltage and the collector current responses are the functions of RC and RE1 only. So in the AC load line, the slope will be the functions of RC and RE1 only. Now we are going to draw the AC load line. Actually, first of all, we are going to draw the DC load line on the output characteristics. So in order to draw the output characteristics, I am going to take the VCE, output voltage, on x-axis and IC on the y-axis. And also, I have drawn the output characteristics. These are all the output characteristics curves. And on the output characteristics, we are going to draw the DC load line. Here, the DC load line points on x-axis and y-axis are on x-axis. This point will be equal to V plus minus of V minus. So here the point on y-axis is V plus minus of V minus divided by RC plus RE1 plus RE2. Okay, that is the point on y-axis for the DC load line. And at the middle of the DC load line, we are going to apply the Q point. And the AC load line has a slope of -1 by RC plus RE1. Okay, so the AC load line was drawn with the dashed line here. Okay, this one is called as AC load line. This one is DC load line. Okay, the slope of the DC load line and AC load line are different. Here the DC load line slope is -1 by RC plus RE1 plus RE2, and AC load line slope is -1 by RC plus RE1. Okay, that is the only difference here. And we are going to apply some base current IB on the Q point. Okay, the base current IB is a sinusoidal AC signal. Okay, and because of this AC excitation at the base of the transistor, we are going to get some output collector current, which is nothing but IC current. Because of this AC collector current across the collector terminal, we are getting some AC output voltage VCE across the collector to emitter terminals. Okay, so this is the output voltage, and this one is the output current, and this one is the input current IA. Okay, so this is about the AC load line analysis. So here we found the slope of the AC load line as well as the slope of the DC load line. Okay, now we are going to see one problem. So determine the DC and AC load lines for the circuit shown in the figure, and assume that the transistor parameters are VBE on is equal to 0.7 volts and beta is equal to 150 and the early voltage VA is equal to infinity. In this circuit, if you observe, this is a PNP type of transistor circuit. Okay, so that's why the emitter terminal was given upper side and the collector terminal was given downside, and the base is the input terminal, collector is the output terminal. Okay, therefore if you take the KVL equation at the output side, V plus into the emitter current is IE, therefore IE into RE plus VCE, output voltage, which was mentioned as VEC because we are taking in the opposite direction, and ICRC, okay, plus V minus, that is the output side KVL equation. And the DC load line equation from this one can be written as VCE is equal to V plus minus of V minus minus IC into RC plus 1 plus beta by beta into RE. We already derived it. Okay, as we are assuming the 1 plus beta by beta is approximately equal to 1, the above equation can be written as VCE is equal to V plus minus of V minus minus IC into RC plus RE. Okay, here the Q point values can be found. So by applying the V plus at the input side, okay, so this is the input side now. Okay, Now we are going to apply the KVL at the input side. Here is the V plus is a voltage which is equal to the base current IBQ, base current IBQ which is flowing in the base of the transistor, plus VEB or VBE which is the voltage between the base to emitter, plus IEQ into RE, okay, which is the input side KVL equation. So from this we can write IBQ is equal to V plus minus VBE by RB plus 1 plus beta into RE. Okay, by rearranging the term we can get it. And now the IBQ value after substituting these values, because they have given the V plus value as 10 volts and the VBE on was given as 0.7 volts, RB was given as here 50 kilo ohms and beta was given as a 150, okay, so which becomes 151, and RE was given as 10 kilo ohms. After substituting these values, we can get IBQ is equal to 5.96 microamperes and ICQ is equal to beta times of IBQ. Okay, so we are going to multiply the IBQ value into 150, which is the beta value, that will be equal to 0.894 milliamperes. We have derived the VCE equation here. Okay, and after assuming the 1 plus beta by beta is equal to 1, this equation can be written as VCEQ is equal to V plus minus V minus minus ICEQ into RC plus RE. Now the VCEQ value will be equal to, after substituting this V plus V minus ICEQ and RC, ICEQ was found as 0.9, okay, so because ICEQ is approximately equal to IEQ, and also the VCEQ value we got it as 6.53 volts. Now we can draw the DC load line as well as AC load line, okay, by using these equations. So on the output characteristics, we can mark the DC load line points like V plus minus V minus, which will gives you the point on X axis, okay, which is equal to here V plus is plus 10 volts and V minus is minus 10 volts, okay. 10 minus of minus 10 is equal to 20 volts, which is a point on X axis, and the point on Y axis will be equal to V plus minus V minus by RC plus RE 1 plus RE 2. Actually, we have derived in the last equation, but here in this circuit, we have only one emitter resistor. Okay, there is no the two emitter resistances like that. Therefore, RE 2 term is not there. Therefore, V plus minus V minus by RC plus RE, which will be equal to 1.33 milliamperes, which is a point on Y axis. Okay, now we are going to get the Q point. The Q point is nothing but a VCEQ value, which is 6.53 volts, which was mentioned on X axis, and ICEQ current we got as 0.894 milliamperes, that is mentioned on Y axis. Okay, so the intercepting point of this VCEQ and ICEQ, which is nothing but the Q point, through this Q point we will draw the AC load line. Okay, AC load line we will draw, and this AC load line slope is nothing but, actually the equation is minus 1 by RC plus RE. Okay, but here if you see, RE will be grounded, sorry, because in the small signal analysis we are going to apply AC. For AC signals, this CE will be act like a short circuit. Okay, therefore there is a short circuit in parallel with RE, so we can neglect the RE. Therefore, the slope will be equal to minus 1 by RC only, but there is a load resistor which is parallel with RC in this circuit. That's why the slope will be equal to RC parallel RL, minus 1 by RC parallel RL. So which was shown here, the slope will be equal to minus 1 by RC parallel RL. After substituting the values, we will get it as minus 1 by 1.43 kilo ohms. Okay, that is the slope of the AC load line. And the DC load line slope will be equal to what? Minus 1 by RC plus RE. Okay, RC plus RE. From the figure, RE value was given as 10 kilo ohms and RC value was given as 5 kilo ohms. Therefore, okay, RC is 5 kilo ohms and RE is 10 kilo ohms. This will be equal to minus 1 by 15 kilo ohms. Like that, we have to do the problems. Okay, next we are going to see the maximum symmetrical swing. Okay, what is meant by maximum symmetrical swing in the sense? So we have just drawn the AC load line, right? So this AC load line will give you the relationship between the AC parameters, which means that how our AC signal varying on the Q point. Okay, when we apply the AC signal to our circuit, the AC signal will be superimposed on the DC currents and voltages. Okay, these AC signals will be superimposed on this DC currents and voltages. Okay, so then what is the maximum voltage or the maximum current that can be given by the amplifier is called as maximum symmetrical swing. Okay, so the maximum in the sense from the positive peak to the negative peak, what is the maximum signal? That is called as maximum symmetrical swing. Okay, so we are going to apply the AC signal to our circuit. Okay, so this AC signal will be superimposed on DC voltages and DC currents. Here if you see the VCEQ value, on the VCEQ value the AC signal will be superimposed like this. What is the maximum voltage that can be given by the amplifier? Okay, that particular maximum values will be given by the maximum symmetrical swing. Okay, they are symmetrical in the sense when you take the sinusoidal signal. Okay, so the symmetrical in the sense the positive side and the negative side should have the same amplitude. Okay, same amplitude and wave shape also should be same. Okay, when a symmetrical sinusoidal signals are applied to the input of an amplifier, symmetrical sinusoidal signals are generated at the output. Okay, which means that when our input is a sinusoidal signal, output should also be a sinusoidal signal which has a symmetrical the positive half cycle and symmetrical negative half cycle. The both half cycles should be symmetrical. Okay, as long as the amplifier operation remains as linear, which means that if the amplifier is working in a linear mode of operation, then this will be applicable. Okay, input is sinusoidal, output is also a sinusoidal. Okay, the maximum symmetrical swing is the maximum output voltage or current that can be generated by the amplifier, okay, without any clippings. So we can use this AC load line to determine the maximum output symmetrical swing of a signal. If the output exceeds the limit, a portion of output signal will be clipped and the signal distortion will occur. Okay, so if you say our amplifier can give maximum of 5 volts, okay, maximum of 5 volts in the both sides, like negative half cycle and the positive half cycle. If our output signal is equal to the 6 volts, then what happened here? The extra portion, whatever we have, that 1 volt will be clipped and the output signal will be like this one. Okay, so this is not exact replica of the input signal. The input signal is a sinusoidal signal, but output signal is a clipped signal, which means that it is not the faithful amplification. There is a change of signal from input to the output. Okay, so it is not the faithful amplification. In order to get the faithful amplification, we must and should have to know the maximum symmetrical swing that can be provided by the amplifier section, so that we will adjust our input signal to get the faithful amplification, which means that no clippings at the output side. So this is about the maximum symmetrical swing. Now we are going to see one problem on maximum symmetrical swing. This is the same circuit what we have seen in the last problem, and here we are going to determine the maximum symmetrical swing in the output voltage of the circuit. So as we have already derived the DC analysis for this particular circuit in the last problem, so I am not going to deriving the IC collector current again and again. Okay, the IC current will be equal to 0.894 milliamperes, and we know that the V plus, okay, when we apply the KVL at the input side, so here is the input side, V plus is equal to VBQ RB plus VBE plus IEQ into RE. Therefore IBQ value will be like this, and I'm getting IBQ current is 5.96 microamperes, and ICQ will be equal to beta times of IBQ, which is 0.894 milliamperes, and IEQ current will be equal to 1 plus beta times of IBQ, which will be equal to 0.9, and the VCEQ value will be equal to 6.53 volts, which we have already seen in the last problem. Okay, therefore the maximum possible symmetrical peak to peak AC collector current can be given as delta times of IC, delta IC, which is the 2 times of the DC collector current, DC quiescent collector current. Okay, therefore the maximum possible symmetrical output AC collector current will be equal to the double of this DC collector current. Okay, so actually this is ICQ. If you take this one is the ICQ line. Okay, therefore we can get a maximum output collector current that will be equal to 2 times of ICQ. Okay, so one ICQ in the positive half cycle, okay, which is in the positive side, another ICQ in the negative side. Okay, the value will be equal to the 2 ICQ. Therefore, the 2 into ICQ value is 0.894, which is equal to 1.79 milliamperes. And the maximum symmetrical peak to peak output voltage will be equal to, we know that V is equal to IR. Output voltage, the change in the output voltage due to application of AC signal, delta VCE is equal to delta IC into RC parallel RL. Therefore, delta IC we calculated as 1.79 milliamperes into RC is 5 kilo ohms and RL is 2 kilo ohms. Therefore, the value will be equal to 2.56 volts. That is the maximum peak to peak output voltage of the AC signal. Okay. Therefore, we can get the maximum instantaneous collector current, which is IC. Okay. That is equal to DC quiescent collector current plus half of the AC collector current. Okay. 1 by 2 into delta IC. Therefore, 0.894 is a DC collector current and 0.894 is the AC collector current, which will be equal to 1.79 milliamperes. Therefore, we calculated the maximum peak to peak output voltage, AC output voltage, and the maximum peak to peak collector current. Okay, so both we calculated. So this is how we have to do the problems. In the next class, we are going to see the CC amplifier and CB amplifier analysis.